Is about to lose the farm. We'll all be sent away.
And there's no telling where we'll end up. Not every human is as kind as ours.
But what can I do?
Nothing.
Babe, the sheep pig returns in triumph to the farm, only to face an immediate emergency in Babe, Pig in the City. One of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. One rule that's rarely broken in the movie industry is the sequel is never as good as the original. Babe, Pig in the City breaks that rule. The first movie, wonderful as it was, and it was good enough to be nominated for a Best Picture Oscar, was like a dress rehearsal for this one, which is enchanting. In the new film, Farmer Hoggett is laid up after an accident, and Babe and Mrs. Hoggett go on the road to earn money. But they're stranded in the city, and just let yourself drink in the details of this cityscape, which audaciously incorporates landmarks from all over the world.
Whatever the case, in this place with its dark corners and endless possibilities, the pig felt sure he would find a way to redeem himself.
The new movie has fewer humans and more animals, although the animals seem human, too.
You got a problem, sweetie?
Who is it, honey?
It's, kind of a baldy, pinky, whitey thingy.
Show him in.
A bull terrier wants to kill Babe until the pig saves him from drowning in one of the city's canals. Then he becomes the pig's loyal lieutenant.
I'd like to offer up a solution that I feel confident you'll all respond to. Whatever the pig says, goes.
What's amazing is the way special effects, animatronic models, and real animals are combined to get these stupendously convincing and amusing shots.
If only there weren't so many of those cats.
Well, someone slapped the dog.
Watch it!
Hey!
Listen!
Hey!
The chief has something to say.
Well... Maybe cats and dogs could, be nicer to each other.
The movie is sophisticated with wicked wit and subtle social commentary, and it's colorful and delightful and funny, too. In no way is it just a children's film, but one of the most original films of the year and one of the best, too. Babe, Pig in the City was directed, co-written, and co-produced by George Miller, who has made an even better film than the original. I was startled how much I liked it.
This is... a magnificent, towering achievement. We're dazzled by it. Mm-hmm. You take any 5-10 minute section of this mm-hmm. picture and you think of the work that went into the construction, mm-hmm. the physical construction, the wit of the writing, mm-hmm. and the charm, of course, of Babe, which was so explicit in the first film and enchanting, mm-hmm. is still in this picture, not dwarfed by the special effects.
What I like about this movie is the story, the dialogue, and the characters all use the effects instead of being the victims of the effects. And every single shot in this movie is enchanting and delightful and magical in its own way. I sat there, I thought, it's too bad adults are going to stay away from this thinking it's some talking pig movie.
Yeah, you can't get it all, possibly. It's so rich wonderful, yeah. So you want to see it again. And I got an idea for George Miller for another sequel. Use the duck more. Make the duck the duck is the second star in this film, that neurotic duck. I love him. Number three in the series. Ferdinand.
Okay,
next film. And our next film is Home Fries, an engaging romantic comedy starring Drew Barrymore as an expectant mother who works at a fast food restaurant called Burgermatic. One night, while tending the drive-through lane, she hears some radio interference on her headphones. Two brothers, well played by Luke Wilson and Jake Busey, have made a tragic attempt to frighten their cheating stepfather. Now they fear that Barrymore has learned through the headphones of their deadly deed. So they visit her at Burgermatic to scope things out.
Oh, these! You know, they are a real time saver. Saves a lot of running around.
I bet you sometimes catch a little interference on them, huh?
Gee, you should have heard the chatter last night.
The more practical brother, played by Wilson, takes a job at the Burgermatic to see if he can find out what Barrymore knows. But eventually, and predictably, he falls in love with her.
How come you never asked me why I need a Lamaze partner or about the father of my baby?
Yesterday, I swear to God, it was a touchy subject, so I'm...
Home Fries gets delightfully complicated as the identity of the father of the baby Barrymore is carrying is revealed to her new boyfriend. Still, he tries to make their unusual relationship work.
I'm the stepbrother, and I'm also the father's stepson, so what I'd like to be the father to be.
You can't be the father and the brother at the same time. That's the kind of thing that messes kids up.
The power of this picture has to do first with its truly offbeat storyline, including the intense way the brothers attack their stepfather and the relaxed romance over a deep fryer between Barrymore and a fresh new face, Luke Wilson. Home Fries doesn't try to be a major motion picture, but it's an appealing one nonetheless.
You know, I had an interesting history with this movie. I saw it at the Toronto Film Festival during the day when I'd seen several other pictures, and I didn't much like it at that time. I felt that the plot was like a broken field runner. They were constantly doing reverses and the revelations and surprises and coincidences, and I was a little put off by it, but I thought, well, a couple of months have passed. I better see it again before reviewing it on the show. The second time, because I could dismiss the plot, I found myself looking at the characters, and I found myself particularly appealed to by Drew Barrymore and by Catherine O'Hara as this sweet, soft-talking, doting mother who is actually kind of a Ma Barker in disguise, who's manipulating her sons in order to scare her husband to death with a helicopter. And I liked the dialogue. I liked a lot of the wit. I found, by the end of the movie, I said to my amazement, I liked it this time. I really did, because the plot wasn't getting in my way.
I think the word affectionate was built for this picture. That's the relationship I had. You know, just, that was kind of fun.
Yeah, it was. Okay, coming up later, Christian Slater and Cameron Diaz cope with the aftermath of a bachelor party gone very wrong in very bad things.
We were very, very bad.
Coming up next, the king of trash TV, Jerry Springer in Ringmaster.
No, wait, hey, hey, hey.
A mother has found her husband in bed with his stepdaughter, and at first she's mad, but then she thinks in this scene, hey, this is our big chance for our first family vacation. Free airplane tickets. We'll turn ourselves over to Jerry Springer. And they're naturals, of course, for the episode of the show titled, I Slept With My Stepdaddy. The new movie named Ringmaster is a fictionalized, behind-the-scenes look at the Jerry Springer Show, the most notorious talk show on TV. And in the movie, Jerry Springer plays a talk show host named Just Jerry.
Jerry, could you sign my T-shirt?
Sure. Want me to sign the back here?
Oh, no. There's a decal back there. You better sign up front. Make it out to Connie. C-O-N-N-I-E.
It's not the spelling I'm having a problem with here.
Springer isn't really the star of the movie, just like he isn't the star of the show. His guests are. And here he looks abashed and bewildered most of the time. But there's good comic chemistry between Molly Hagan as the mother and Jamie Presley as her daughter. After the daughter cheats with her stepfather, the mother's husband, her mother gets revenge with her daughter's boyfriend.
When my mother started having an affair with my fiancé, she borrowed my clothes and my diaphragm.
That's white people nasty.
Another coosome foursome are also headed for Jerry's show. They're played by Wendy Raquel Robinson, whose boyfriend, played by Michael J. White, has cheated with two of her best friends.
Where are we going? How are we going to get there? We in the air. Why you going to stay turn around in your seat. Don't take your partner.
Ringmaster is not a good movie. It doesn't have the kind of intelligence and insight you can see in material like The Larry Sanders Show, which is also about the making of a TV program. But it's a better movie than I expected because of the energy and accuracy of the various cheaters, and especially because of the chemistry between Molly Hagan and Jamie Presley as a mother and daughter who have never really had a chance to grow up together, or for that matter, at all. There are some laughs and some energy in the movie, even if Springer himself sometimes tries to almost hide from the camera. It's not a good film, but it's an interesting one.
Yeah, I didn't think it was particularly interesting. I've never seen his show.
Really?
And I wasn't interested in this set of people. And here's one thing that he does in the film that sort of offended me, or my intelligence at least. Mm-hmm. He says that, you know, the reason why he's censured so much is that this is what poor people are like, his show. Mm-hmm. And, you know, my response to that is, I'm not so sure. I think this is what possibly poorer people might be like if you dangle a plane ticket in front of them, and you call it a vacation, and shine lights on them, and they know that the only way that they're going to get on is to act out.
Yeah, the format of the show is 25 minutes of a freak show followed by Jerry's little sermon, in which he finds some homily that he can offer on the basis of the fact that he has trashed these people. However, what he says in this movie is, in our society, rich people get to be humiliated in public, in the tabloids, and on the gossip shows, and what he's doing is just giving poor people an opportunity to be humiliated in the same way, and in a sense, he's right, because these people know exactly what they're getting into. There's nobody who goes on that show who could be described as an innocent victim, and it's simply goofy, silly, trashy, vulgar entertainment.
The movie is bad because it doesn't tell me anything new about him.
Coming up next, Cameron Diaz learns her fiancé is in big trouble in Very Bad Things.
What have we done?
What have we done?
What did you do?
I have been doing all of this by myself. I have done absolutely everything by myself, okay? Everything has been on my own, okay? I've been doing it all. I bet you didn't forget the bachelor party checks.
Cameron Diaz is stressed out by her wedding plans and takes out her anxiety on her fiancé, played by Jon Favreau, in the new movie Very Bad Things, a thoroughly depressing black comedy about a bachelor party gone fatally wrong. Even though the bride warns her fiancé not to participate, he does go to Vegas with four friends, including a couple of quarreling brothers, who party with booze, drugs, and a prostitute who meets a violent death. And she isn't the only victim. The five take a vow of silence that isn't kept, and the grisly way they deal with the bodies will have you wishing for the wood chipper in Fargo. Christian Slater plays the mastermind to try to get them out of trouble.
Have you done this before?
The reality is, you take away the horror of the situation, take away the tragedy of the death, take away the moral and ethical implications of all that you've had conditioned and beaten into your head since grade one, what are we left with? What? It's a 105-pound problem.
Possibly writer-director Peter Berg's intention with this film was to make murder comic through overkill. But because his characters are so flat and empty, we are simply overwhelmed and numbed by the graphic violence. I was truly surprised by how underdeveloped the Cameron Diaz character was in Very Bad Things. Other than being a stickler for the type of chair she wants at her wedding, I can't think of anything distinctive about her. What a waste. Here you have one of the hottest actresses on the screen today. Why give her, and why did she accept, a nothing role?
Well, she does have a big scene at the end where she pulls some of the many plot threads together, but I agree with you. This movie left me feeling sad and angry and depressed. And I thought there is nothing funny about this material. Furthermore, I didn't find the racial implications very pleasant either. A point is made that this group of bachelors includes several people who are Jewish, and that spins off some Jewish jokes, if you want to call them that, about body bags and body parts that I found thoroughly distasteful, especially since their victims are an Asian woman and a black man. I thought, what's that about? It seemed to me this is basically a serious drama, maybe, and would have been better there as a serious drama, and that by trying to force it into humor, it just made it obscene.
It seems to be open season on Jews in the movies. They're rarely portrayed in any way other than in a comic way and in a derisive way, and so this is just adds to the list.
Well, I didn't think that the blacks and the Asians came off very well either. In fact, nobody comes off well from this film.
No. Okay. Especially the audience.
Okay, next movie. Our next movie, named Savior, uses some fairly heavy-handed drama to show the redemption of a man whose life is consumed by revenge. The message of the movie is not subtle, but a lot of the acting is, especially a lead performance by Dennis Quaid, who, as the movie opens, is seen in a happy moment in Paris with his wife, Nastasia Kinski, and their child.
Don't you believe in God?
But you don't have to go to church to believe in God. God is everywhere. He's inside you. He's in me. He's in mommy.
Even in bad people.
Seconds later, his happiness is ended by a terrorist bomb. Blaming Muslims, he walks into a mosque and kills everyone he sees as they kneel at prayer. And then he joins the French Foreign Legion and disappears. Some years later, he surfaces as a mercenary in Serbia.
Not many Western men here for Serbs, you know. Most of them think we are the bad guys. It's good to have someone like you to see what's going on here.
He encounters a young woman who has been raped by a soldier from the other side and disowned by her own family. She and her child face certain death, and the loner, against his principles, finds himself trying to help them.
Why do you need to help me?
Need?
Yes, I can see you need that. I am from here. Somehow they're right when they say I was not a good Serb woman.
It's not true. Listen to me. What happened to you? It wasn't your fault.
The message of the movie is a worthy one. Killing is wrong, and hating others on the basis of their race or religion is wrong, too. It's a very simple message, and yet millions of people have never learned it, and Savior is the story of one who belatedly does. I could see the wheels of the plot turning, and the symbolism is right up front. When the movie settles down to the story of the man, the woman, and the child, it takes on a kind of purity and strength that make it work, and the ending is powerful.
Yeah, I liked it, too, and it did creep up on me. The message that you communicate, yes, and it stands in distinction to us. The film we just reviewed,
yes,
Very Bad Things.
Yes.
And Quaid's character is worth following on this unpredictable journey where you do feel he is genuinely at risk and he has principles. Rarely do we find movie characters, it's just I think about it, that have principles that they act on. Mm-hmm. Here's an example. It's a good film.
You're right. When we come back, a tribute to the director, Alan Pakula.
Siskel and Ebert's Video Pick of the Week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinettes. At the movies or at home, Raisinettes.
The director, Alan J. Pakula, died last week at the age of 70. He was preparing a film and seemed ready to make many more, and now we'll never see them. He leaves behind a rich legacy of movies that often got more publicity for their actors than for the director. He was a quiet, thoughtful, courteous man with a wry sense of humor, and he made some good movies. He began as a producer, teaming up with director Robert Mulligan on such classics as To Kill a Mockingbird. But in 1969, he decided to direct his own films, and I met him for the first time in upstate New York on the set of his debut picture, The Sterile Cuckoo. It was also Liza Minnelli's screen debut as a confused college girl.
90% of Nancy Putnam's body is by DuPont. Fiberglass boobs. Fiberglass brain.
In 1971, he made the powerful Clute, containing Jane Fonda's Oscar-winning performance as an articulate but troubled prostitute.
They're usually nervous, which is fine because I'm not. I know what I'm doing. And for an hour, I'm the best actress in the world.
In 1976 came All the President's Men, the riveting story of the Watergate scandal with Dustin Hoffman and Robert Redford. And in 1982 came Sophie's Choice with Meryl Streep's Oscar-winning performance as a Polish woman still tormented by guilt about her past as a Nazi prisoner.
Du kannst eins von den Kindern behalten.
Wie bitte?
Du kannst eins von den Kindern behalten. Das andere muss weg.
And in 1990 came Presumed Innocent, with Harrison Ford starring in the Scott Turow bestseller about a prosecutor who becomes a suspect.
All I want to do is tell the truth. The jury wants to hear me say I didn't do it.
And all of those titles would be very good choices to rent on home video. Alan Pakula was the kind of man everybody in the industry knew and respected, even though he didn't have the high profile of some of his contemporaries. He was known for well-crafted films and for his attention to actors and their performances. He was motivated by two things, said Meryl Streep in her tribute, his principles and love.
I had the pleasure of meeting him on a couple of occasions, and I was always struck by his intelligence and craftsmanship. Mm-hmm. And I think that he was drawn to that kind of material, intelligent material. So I mourn his loss because so much of what we're getting in films today is vulgar, and he would have none of that.
Absolutely right. We'll be back in just a moment. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two very enthusiastic thumbs way up for Babe, Pig in the City. We both think it's one of the year's best films, even better than the first film, amazingly. Two thumbs up for Home Fries, and especially for the quirky, engaging performances by Drew Barrymore, Catherine O'Hara, and Luke Wilson. Two thumbs down for Ringmaster. Way down, Gene says. Jerry Springer's big screen debut, although I thought it was more interesting than he did. Two thumbs way down for Very Bad Things, a comedy about things that are not only bad, but simply not funny. And finally, two thumbs up for Savior, where Dennis Quaid's performance overcomes heavy-handed symbolism.
Remember, you can hear our reviews on the web at Siskel-Ebert.com. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including the new animated feature, The Prince of Egypt, and the thriller, A Simple Plan, starring Bill Paxton and Billy Bob Thornton as brothers who find a bag full of money in a downed plane. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
When it comes to consumer electronics, everything you need to make an informed decision is now in one place. 800.com, the ultimate electronics zone.
There's one way to guarantee whiter teeth. Rapid White by Natural White whitens teeth. Safe, effective. Rapid White by Natural White, we guarantee whiter teeth.
Embark on the Mist Challenge with your friends. Enjoy twists and turns never before seen in a board game. The Mist Board Game by University Games.
The new Roger Ebert's Movie Yearbook 1999, now with every recent Ebert movie review, available at bookstores everywhere.